Hello everyone, I'm Robbe from Robodus Productions, and today I'm going to make a review of my Dell XPS 17 after I've owned and used it for 9 months. And in some cases I will also compare the laptop to a 7-year-old second-hand MacBook Pro. Let's get into it. So first, I just want to clarify, the Dell XPS 17 just is an awesome laptop, and I guess one of the best Windows laptops you can get today. I want to clarify that I'm going to talk about of my own opinion and my experience, so things I say may be different to you. And I'm also going to point out everything I've noticed. There are things that are more important than other. A lot of things also do not matter to me and shouldn't matter to you, but I'm just gonna tell you everything that you know what you're getting yourself into when you buy a Dell XPS 17. The first question that I want to answer is, do I recommend the laptop? And that is, I guess, a big no. It is a very good laptop, but for that kind of money you could and should get something else with less or as much of tiny issues, but for a lower price, because at this price point there are just too much things wrong with it. Is it Dell's fault, is it my own fault, or is it just the nature of Windows? I guess a bit of all. First off, I'm going to boot up the Dell XPS 17 and the MacBook Pro at the same time. The Dell is in hibernate because sleep mode does not work, more on that later. And the MacBook has been turned off or put into sleep mode more than a day ago, so that means that it is also has gone into some kind of hybrid sleep mode. So we will see what takes the longest. So on the MacBook, I'm already on my login screen. I will now press in my PIN code. So I'm now logged in and the laptop is responsive and working as it should. After I've done all of that, now I'm on the login screen of my XPS and the face unlock just immediately unlocks my laptop. I have the Dell XPS 17, the 9700 is the model name, with a 4K touch display, the 10th gen i7 processor, the 10875H. It has 8 cores and 16 threads. I have the RTX 2060 6GB Max-Q variant. It supports up to 64 gigs of dual channel DDR4 at the speed of 2933 MHz. The laptop comes with Wi-Fi 6. The webcam is 720p at 30fps. It has a 79 watt hour battery, Windows Hello face unlock, a fingerprint scanner, 4 Thunderbolt 3 ports, an SD card reader and headphone jack. It comes with a 130 watt Type-C power adapter in the box. The display has 3840 by 2400 resolution and covers 100% of the Adobe RGB color space. It has around 500 nits of sustained brightness, but that can vary a little bit from model to model. It supports HDR and it has a 1600:1 contrast ratio. My laptop came with 16GB of RAM and I have upgraded it to 32. And it only had a 1TB SSD, so I added another 2TB NVMe drive myself. Let's get the list of issues, or inconveniences as I want to call them, out of the way, so we can move on with the good stuff afterwards. It already starts when you want to buy a laptop. It was difficult to get the order placed. After a few days of contact with support and different payment methods, I finally had an order, so that was already a rough start to the owning experience of a Dell XPS. Just to get in contact with support before you placed an order, it is kinda impossible or something. After you have the order number, it is fairly easy to get someone on the phone to have contact with. When I took it out of the box, I was happy that everything was fine with my unit, until I turned it on, because then there are a lot of issues that I immediately noticed in the first 2 to 3 days of owning the laptop. A lot of these issues, there are software issues, but we also noticed on the recently bought Dell XPS 13 from a few weeks old, so it isn't solved yet. The things is that the default Windows installation on the laptop has a lot of things that were wrong or not perfect in it, and I'm going to talk about everything that I still remember. There was some bloatware software, I don't know it everything anymore, but McAfee is one of them, and it is kind of a pain in the ass to get rid of your computer. Then there were some graphical issues and some glitches on the screen when maximizing, minimizing windows, when connecting to other displays, sometimes the content of a program was just blank and things like that, so that wasn't awesome. There were some frame drop and there were some glitches in the performance of the laptop. In Windows Explorer, there would be a weird white bar in between the search bar and the content of the window, just weird white bar. I don't know what the reason is of that, but that was there. Also, Windows Explorer crashed a lot and wasn't that stable. So transferring files, I did that with TerraCopy because Windows Explorer was just crashing too often. There was a fairly high CPU usage on idle, and because of that, the battery life wasn't what I expected. When I played music or a game or a video, sometimes there were some weird pops and cracks that came out of the speakers. So that are some issues in Windows that weren't that nice to discover when you I've waited a long time for this laptop, and I also spent a lot of money on it. After all of this, one day later, I wanted to turn the laptop on and it did nothing. Plugged in a power adapter, took out the power adapter, pressed the power button for over a minute, tried to do some weird key combos, then it would boot into some recovery device check with certain key combination. But after that was finished and the screen went every color it can, it still wouldn't boot. Then I noticed something very funny or worrying, I don't know, because it was a laptop that just came out and there was already a detailed document on the Dell website about what you should do when the laptop does not turn on, with a lot of pictures and descriptions. They told you to open up the laptop, which is fairly hard because the bottom is on very tight, but when you get the bottom off without damaging the laptop, it is besides that fairly easy to open because there are only some screws at the bottom, and then you click off the bottom plate. Then you needed to disconnect the battery, press and hold the power button for a certain amount of time, and after all of that you reconnect the battery, plug in the power cable, and then the laptop booted. But then, when the laptop turned on, there was a fault in the Windows boot record, so the laptop would not boot. So I tried to boot it in the command prompt. I did some recovery of the Windows boot directory in the command prompt, but all of that didn't help to solve the issue. So I reinstalled Windows after all of that, and actually, I was very happy I did, because of course, there is no bloatware when you do a clean install of Windows. The reinstallation of all the drivers and the Dell services was very easy, and all of them work on my laptop. The graphical glitches in Explorer were gone. Explorer is much more stable now. The graphical glitches and the frame drops also went away. There are no cracks and pops out of my speakers anymore. And the battery life is also better because of a lower CPU usage on idle. So I kind of recommend for everyone that buys a Dell, and actually kind of every laptop or every pre-built PC, to do just a clean install of Windows, install the drivers yourself in case that you're comfortable with it, because then you most of the time get a much cleaner environment with less weird things that they try to change to make it better. But there are still some other issues that were not solved by reinstalling Windows. If there are issues or inconveniences, I guess that's a little bit up to you. But one thing that I want to point out is that battery life isn't that reliable, I would say. Sometimes you can get a lot of time out of the battery, other days it is far less, not with doing that much different or having the screen brightness that much higher or lower. It is just like one day it's more like 6 hours, the other day it's more like 3 hours, and I don't know what the difference is there. To compare it to my MacBook, okay, it's an older device, so I do not get that much battery life out of it, around 3 hours to 4. But I know, kind of with everything I do on the laptop, I definitely get 2 to 2.5 hours and tops 4 hours. But on the Dell, some days I can get 10 hours when I do my best to save the battery, and at the same time, I could all so kill it in less than an hour, so that isn't that reliable, and a very big contrast. To continue to talk about power problems, the power adapter that comes with the laptop is just too weak. It is a 130 watt adapter, but when you game on it for a few hours, after a few hours you're done with gaming because the battery is dead. Yeah, that's while the laptop is plugged in. Also, when you want to charge the laptop with different adapter or a power bank, it complains a lot about the this is a too weak power adapter, or things like that. Sometimes it would not charge. Another time, Windows just said, "Hey, there's no battery in the device," while I was plugged into a 90 watts or 59 watts power adapter. So that are just some weird things when you use not the official power adapter, and even with the Dell power bank, it often does weird. When you connect a power adapter that is not the 90 watts or 95 watts or higher, the laptop also would not boot and says to use another power adapter or just boot from the battery and then plug in the cable again, so that's kind of inconvenient and not that handy. Also, there is a little bit of resonance in the chassis from the speakers that might have to do with the EQ I've set, but still, if there is a bit of resonance in the chassis, that means that not everything is just that refined as it would be on a MacBook, for example. There is also a very big problem with the laptop going to sleep. On Windows devices, when you put the device to sleep, the device shuts off, but the memory stays powered, so when there is power again, it can just take off where you left it the last day or beforehand, because of everything that was open still is in the memory. This calls S3 power state, so everything is off, the memory is powered with all the data in it from all the programs that we're running. But because this is a newer device and it allows low power mode or something like that, that's called the S0 power mode, it would not do that. It would turn off the screen and go into a low power state, quote unquote, to sync things in the background, keep a bit running. And I guess on a U processor that might not be a problem, because this is a H series of processor, it can use a lot of power, and sometimes just in the middle of the night the laptop is having the fans running at a very loud noise. When you put it in a backpack, it's just trying to catch on fire. I don't know, the battery drains over a night, the battery is almost dead, so that is not something you can use. So I just need to use the Hibernate, and as you saw in the beginning, it is not that it takes that long of a time, but in my opinion it is just too long. I just want to open the lid and be ready to use the laptop. I also called the Dell representative about it. It was just a weird conversation. Like I said, I want to use sleep mode on my laptop without my backpack catching on fire, and I paid a lot for this laptop, so I kind of expect this basic feature to work. And then he just told me that I should not expect anything based on the price I pay. So that's just a weird thing to say, because I guess when I spend more, I should expect a little bit more, but okay. Then another issue with turning off the laptop. After a few times I've turned off the laptop in Hibernate, after 10, 15, 20 times, the laptop would not turn off. It would just stay on. You hear the fans running when you open the lid. The laptop is still on. Whatever you do, it does not go into Hibernate or sleep mode. It only works if you then shut down or restart the laptop, which is also very annoying. Okay, then a few other little tiny things that are annoying, but then I'm done with the negative stuff. There is no pen support on the laptop. Like, you can use a capacitive touch pen, which I have, but not a real pen to have nice drawing capabilities, because that would be handy on this laptop. And there is a noticeable amount of input lag, especially while gaming. But now I'm done with talking about all the negative stuff and all the inconvenience, so let's move on to the good stuff, because there is a lot to cover here. The boring part, let's get that out of the way first. The performance of the laptop is just awesome. I did not run any benchmarks or things on the device, because I don't care that much about the performance, in the sense of I don't care if it is the fastest CPU or middle range CPU. If it just gets the job done that I wanted to do, it's fast enough for me. I bought this laptop for programming, CAD drawings, going to school, building websites, editing some videos, editing some photos, sometimes play some games and just watch movies on it and do things with music. All of that. At the same time, it just works and gets the job done. When I just use Office programs, the browser, Windows Explorer, some file things, as if the laptop or the computer can keep up with how fast I'm clicking and reading things, it is fast enough for me. It should be as fast or faster than I can use the computer, so I do not need to wait every click that I take. And as you might expect from this powerful of a machine, it just does that without any issue and it just keeps going. So for me, the computer is more as fast enough. It just has a lot of headroom, whatever you're doing. Also, running VMs and multitasking goes like a charm. I would say it is kind of the perfect desktop replacement. The build quality, the finish and the refinement is just awesome on this laptop. It is, I guess, not as good as a MacBook, but so darn close. The reason why I say it is because I just have the feeling when picking up this laptop, moving around this laptop, it feels more fragile and more prone to breaking, and that just makes me feel that it is a little bit less than a MacBook. That's my opinion. The screen, I don't know what to say about it, besides that it is just so fantastic. The taller aspect ratio makes it handy for web browsing and typing documents. The 4K is overkill at this resolution, but oh god, does it look good. It has touch capabilities, so I can open up programs, tick away on things, do things with the touchscreen. It is just handy. That is, for me, a must on a laptop right now. It is a shame that none of the MacBooks have touch. The colors and the brightness of the display is just awesome. Indoor, outdoor use, just amazing. They say it is anti-reflective, but I sometimes have a little bit of issue when there is some harsh light hitting the screen, but besides of that, it's just amazing. The speakers of the device are awesome. There is a little bit of resonance like I already said, but I think that have might to do with the EQ I've set. They are very loud, very clear, very full sound with enough bass. They can fill a room without that much problem. The surround simulation for watching movies is just amazing and works perfectly. There is no way to need a Bluetooth speaker downstairs when you want to listen to some music while you work. So there is good stereo separation, but one weird thing is when you plug in some speakers or something to the audio jack of the device, it sounds not as it should sound, in my opinion. If I compare it to other devices, my MacBook, my phone, my desktop, it just sounds a little bit different, and that is with all the weird EQ settings from the EQ program turned off. When the EQ things are turned on, it just sounds awful, and you should just disable all of that when you're using external speakers. The battery life on the laptop has a bright and a dark side. On a long day of school, I managed to get around 8 to 9 hours of battery life, but that is with the screen on the lowest brightness, no keyboard backlighting, even if the room where I'm having a class in was very dark. Only using Word editor, PDF documents, sometimes searching something on the web, and I think the way I tried to conserve the battery was just too overkill and not convenient and not the way you should use this laptop. So I probably would say that around 6 hours of battery life is something you can get. But when you use the computer very hard with some gaming, some editing, some 3D CAD drawing, you can also drain the battery in less than 2 hours. I also have this Dell power bank that I bought with the computer. It does not charge the computer, because when the computer is turned off and you plug this in, it says that there is a charging error in the BIOS, so it would not charge. But when the computer is turned on and I plug this in, the computer would not lose charge anymore, and depending on what you're doing, it also gains a few percentages. So that is around 40 minutes to an hour that you do not lose charge on your computer and maybe gain 5 to 15% depending on the usage. So that is always handy to have, and the USB port on it also charges your phone or something, but also works as a USB port to connect a USB thumb drive or something to your laptop. But a good thing on the battery life is that when you put the laptop in the Dell Power Manager on the Express Charge function, it just charges the laptop in 1.5 hours or something. The last few percentages just take a long time to charge, keep the battery in good health for a longer time. I use the laptop almost all the time on battery, because when I compare it to a MacBook works the same if it is plugged in or is running on battery. So when you're not doing a whole lot, or the fans are just turned off, or they are spinning so slow that you don't hear them. On the Dell, when you're in battery power, that's the same. The fans, you do not hear them, or they are turned off. But when you plug in a power adapter, the laptop thinks like, oh yeah, I now have a power adapter, so I can ramp up the clock speed of my CPU. Then the laptop becomes hotter and the fans kick in. So that means that you're always greeted with some very noticeable fan noise. Not that it is very loud or annoying, but you just hear it. So that's the reason that I almost use it all the time on battery, because it is quieter, it's easier, and I will just charge it up in between I use it. The feel of the laptop and everything you touch and use is just very awesome. The trackpad is very big, very smooth, and works very good. The click may be a little bit loud, and that's also noticeable when you are using the integrated microphones. They are fairly good for a laptop, but the noise of the keyboard and the noise of the trackpad is just fairly noticeable in video calls. Thank God NVIDIA Broadcast is a thing, but that's something point out that might be not what you want. The trackpad is one of the best I've felt and used on a Windows device. Can't complain about it. Gestures work just perfectly. The webcam is very usable. It is good from far, but far from good.
So here you have a sample of the how the webcam looks and how it sounds. I will also type something, and then you can see what you hear. I am now typing very softly on my keyboard to let you see what you notice. Then when I just start typing normal, this is what you hear then, and when I'm typing fairly loud or fairly harsh on the keyboard, I guess you'll here that's much larger, so. Now when I click my trackpad, we'll see what you hear then, because that's also something that is, for what I've heard from other people, very noticeable in the microphone recording. But here's that.
What I mean by that is to use it for some video calls and just some to let people see your face or something, it is good enough. But it isn't 1080p, it isn't a higher refresh rate, exposure and the lighting isn't that good, so it is usable, it gets the job done, but not in a way you expect a laptop of this caliber and at this price point to get the job done. You should expect and should get something better. Okay, besides the screen, is keyboard just the best thing about this laptop, I guess? Not for gaming, because then I would use my K100, as you saw me unbox in my first video, but for typing, it just is the best I've ever used. Mechanical keyboards with brown switches, Razer optical switches, clicky switches, tactile switches, linear switches, I don't care, an Apple Magic keyboard, an Apple keyboard. This is just the best keyboard I have used, and for typing almost everything I only use this one. I just love this keyboard. It's just awesome. I can't say anything else about it. It sounds very nice. It has a nice tactical feel. There is some key travel in it. It sounds fairly nice. It is quiet when you type very softly on it, but when you go ham on the keyboard, it has a pleasant sound to it. I just love this keyboard, and Dell XPS keyboards in the past have already been good, but this is again just that little bit better. So yeah, the interfaces and connectivity of this device is very good. Like I mentioned earlier, it has a fast Wi-Fi card that is very stable, has good speeds, good reliability. The Bluetooth just works fine, connecting to speaker, keyboard, mouse, phone, a headset, all at the same time, that's no problem. The reliability is awesome, the connection, connecting a mouse and things like that just goes very fast. You turn on the mouse and it is connected and it works. And before you start doubting or disagreeing with me, hear me out. I like the fact that the device has 4 Type-C or 4 Thunderbolt ports on it. I don't need a mouse, a keyboard, another display or something, because the display, the keyboard and mouse on this laptop is just so good already that I'm a fan of using a trackpad. The SD card slot is very fast and is good for offloading some media from camera or drone. Okay, the fact that there is no HDMI out or just not one USB port sometimes is a little bit frustrating, because all of the time you have to take out a dongle, no matter what dongle it is, you just need to take one out. And connecting a display via a dongle over the HDMI or VGA port is sometimes just a little bit more difficult, because the laptop and a display and things sometimes get a little bit picky of what dongle you're using. And the fact that not all of my, and probably not yours USB thumb drives are Type-C means that sometimes you ran upstairs to get a USB drive, went downstairs to plug it into your device, and yeah, what then? Oh, damn, I forgot the dongle, I need to go back upstairs, so. Just in all of my bags I have this adapter, on one side is this USB-A port, on the other side is Type-C, so I can plug in everything. That's very easy to have lying around everywhere, but then you also get the opposite. This side has a USB-A port, and on the other side it has a Type-C port, because you might carry a lot of Type-C accessories around you, but not all of the devices that you would use day-to-day might have a USB-C port, so that also means that you need sometimes to convert your Type-C SSD to just a USB-A drive so you can connect it to, in this case, my MacBook Pro. Also, the fact that it is Type-C on all the sides means that no matter where you put the device, you can see like, oh, I can plug in this dongle now on this side. When the laptops are switched, I could plug it in on this side. You can put the charger wherever you want. It does not matter. One of the best things is a docking station, the Dell dock. It's very good in my opinion. And so price to performance, the Dell dock is very good. And when you compare to the competition, it gets a lot done for fairly reasonable price. The one I have is Thunderbolt 3. It has 3 USB ports, USB-A ports, 2 display ports, 1 HDMI port, and 1 Type-C port that you can also use as a display port, and just a normal Type-C port and a gigabit Ethernet port. Charge the laptop with 100 watts of power. You can connect up to 3 monitors to it, and I think it supports 2 4K monitors at the same time. It is just one cable solution to run your whole setup of a laptop. Disconnect it, go to a meeting, you're ready, you come back, plug it in, and it works. I like the dongles because it is very versatile. It is one cable, you can plug in multiple USB devices, displays, Ethernet and things like that with one cable in your laptop, so that makes your desk a lot cleaner because you can put the dongle behind the laptop and then your cables are out of the way. The Dell laptop already comes with one dongle in the box. It has a HDMI and a USB port and this nice handy foldable cable. It's USB 3 port, so that's fast enough, but the HDMI port, to my experience, did not support 4K60. Then the upgradability of the laptop is, I guess, very amazing for a laptop this day and age in the form factor that it has. Like I said earlier, I have upgraded my SSD and RAM in the beginning, but also the Wi-Fi card and the battery are very easy user accessible and user replaceable. So that's a good point for this laptop and to keep it working a little bit longer, because when something breaks or maybe a new standard of Wi-Fi or Bluetooth comes out, you can upgrade it. When you need more memory, you can put up to 64 gigs of memory in it. When you're out of storage, you can just put in an extra SSD because you have two fast NVMe slots in this laptop. When your battery has degraded over time, Dell has a lot of software features and things built in to prevent that from happening. But when that happens, you can just take out the battery and put a new one in. That's just thinking about the user and the people that buy this device. Then a few tips and tricks, or some things that I've figured out over time, is that in the Intel Graphics Command Center, I recommend turning off all the power saving features, because when you you're going to system and to power, I've turned off everything besides panel self-refresh. After I did this, the screen just became that much more beautiful. It looked that much better. I did not notice that much of a difference in my battery consumption, and I think it's worth it to have the best looking screen out there. I recommend turning off the keyboard backlighting, because even in a fairly dark environment, the keyboard is fairly readable without the backlight turned on. Okay, it looks darn good, but the keyboard backlight consumes a lot of power of the laptop. So like you might have already seen, I have a dbrand skin on my Dell XPS just to protect the laptop and have it look a little less boring. But one thing that has happened over time is that, as you might already have seen in some shots, is that the corners came loose here, and with some leftover I tried to patch these up with a Padron in the same way. So when you do not know it, you won't notice it, but that's just something that happened, and that's not because the skin isn't applied appropriately, because it is straight on here, the logo isn't centered, I know that, but the big black carbon fiber piece is where it should be, but the skin was just the same size, or maybe that little bit larger than the screen of my laptop, so it came loose in the corners. I also have a touch pen, like I mentioned earlier. It is a soft top at the one side, and the other side it's a hard pen, so for drawing things on the device, it's far better than using your finger or using a pen with a rubber top or something on it, because that isn't that accurate. So I can easily write stuff on my display, take notes in the LESS, or highlight something in a PDF document. I could not be more happy and fortunate to own this laptop and this awesome piece of technology. But for the price it starts at and the price of my machine that I've tested and used, there are a lot of things that could be done a bit to a lot better, and I would hope they'll too figure some of that stuff out in the future. I guess if you want a complete package of a Windows laptop with upgradability, Thunderbolt, Type-C charging, face unlock, good speakers, awesome keyboard, touchscreen, high resolution, a larger laptop, decent battery life, professional looking, a taller aspect ratio, the fast performance and all of that, I think there is nothing else on the market that you can get. Like HP Spectre 15 or something comes very close, but it lacks a bit in the performance department. It's a little bit smaller, it does not have the tall aspect ratio. It only has two Type-C ports, so when you connect a dock to it and want to use Type-C for charging, you're out of Type-C ports. So it's a little bit difficult to find something that is as good or comes very close to this laptop. So yeah, thanks for watching. I hope you have enjoyed this video. In case of that, please hit that like button, subscribe to my channel, hit the notification bell, and leave a comment down below of what you think Dell could have done better, and what your experience might be if you also use a Dell XPS device. Thanks for watching, and goodbye.